So we can start now.
Okay. Sorry. So good afternoon, everybody. I hope everybody
has your video. Video.
Can you see the full slide?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Okay. I'm not turning the video just in case of there is a bandwidth issue. And sometimes that causes problems. So I'm just not using the video. That's the reason.
Perfect, sir, perfect.
Okay. Okay. So hopefully everybody had a good healthy break and we are back again with mass spectrometry, and this time we'll talk about how mass spectrometry is useful in omics studies. Okay, so before we go into that, we will first try to see what is omics and why we are interested in omics at all, and then what all different kind of omics that are there, and particularly the ones where mass spectrometry has been applied and has contributed significantly and is contributing significantly. And then we'll take up some of the examples. And as I promised last time, that we'll at least discuss some of the mass analyzers which are commonly used and which are relatively simple to understand as well. And then we'll go on discussing how we can use those kind of mass spectrometers, mass analyzers, in order to study omics, and what do we get at the end of the day doing that. Okay, is there anything, something really significant that we can do that we couldn't do without that? Okay, so omics first. So as we know, this is the central dogma of life. Apparently we all used to think that long back that once we understand and once we have read the whole genome, we should be able to really predict what is the phenotype. And this was probably the secret of life that we were all looking forward to, but that hasn't really turned out as it is, as we expected. So just to give you an example, only 10% of the global disease burden can at the moment can be significantly explained by genomics alone. Several diseases, including some of the lifestyle associated diseases that we are seeing, which are skyrocketing, you know, be it obesity, be it diabetes, all kind of metabolic syndrome, as well as cancer, not all of them can be explained by the genome. And see, at the end of the day, what we would really like to do, as you know, not only for the sake of understanding, for simple pure query and pure pursuit of knowledge, but also from a very application point of view, we would like to understand why individuals vary from person to person, why things vary. Why susceptibility to disease vary? Why outcome of a disease vary? Currently we are amid a pandemic, and we know that there are several risk factors that we know that if you have comorbidity, et cetera, et cetera, you are supposed to have a high risk if you contract the disease. However, that is not really true, as we probably see around. There are plenty of examples of people who have significant so-called quote-unquote comorbidities, but they do not really have an adverse consequence of the disease. On the other hand, there are several other examples. People without any significant comorbidity, which and they perish and very swiftly, and sometimes even in after apparent recovery from the disease, and we don't understand why. And there is a lot of effort going on, both in terms of genomics as well as other fields. We don't have a clear answer yet. Okay, So if we now look at that, we are not an isolated system. We are constantly interacting with the environment, and then it is the environment that really affects, you know, how whatever is encoded in the gene, how that is actually read and how that is actually transcribed and translated into action. So we, at the end of the day, see the function or type. That's what we see, and this is what we are trying to understand. So if we just try to focus on a particular, you know, let's say genome or transcriptome or a particular set of gene or gene product, then we are always going to be misled, because all of these intertwined interactions together ultimately leads to the phenotype. And therefore, particularly if we miss the ones that is towards the end of the, or towards, you know, at the lower, at the bottom of the information cascade, and which is the proximal to the phenotype, then we are certainly going to miss how, you know, how to correlate the genotype and the environment with the phenotype. So this is where the whole idea of looking biology in totality, in holistic perspective, that you need to look into all different kinds of information flow and interactions that are present there. Therefore, you need to look into all kinds of molecules and their behavior. And that is the genesis of omics, okay? And now let us try to see what are, you know, different types of omics where mass spec has really significantly helped to. So one is metabolomics, which is basically, you know, all the metabolites. And when we are getting metabolites, lipid volatiles, etc., we primarily indicate that they should be endogenous in origin. A lot of lipid which are from outside. So as long as, you know, they are inside and a part of the biochemical landscape, then only we should consider that a part of the omics that we are interested in. Anything which is external, which we are exposed to, is a part of exposomics, which we'll come to later on. So anyway, metabolomics, then lipidomics, volatomics, study of all volatiles. There are plenty of molecules that are volatile in nature and comes out, for example, the composition of our breath. As well as, you know, there are like scents, the aromas that you can smell, you know, stuffs like plant, or even we have particular types of aroma. There has been studies where people showed that there are particular types of compounds which actually are secreted from individuals which attract mosquitoes preferentially. Okay, so these are all very important small molecules, but signaling molecules, not only inside the body, but also they dictate how we interact with our environment, including, you know, the vectors and pathogens, etc. And then we certainly have proteomics, peptidomics, glycomics, the study of all glycans, epitranscriptome. This is just something that is really coming up, and this is something where we are working on. It's akin to epigenomics, but this is looking into the chemical modifications that are present in the transcriptome. And then there is metallomics, looking into the distribution of metal ions inside a living system. And then immunomics, all molecular features of the immune system. And this is where, you know, I hope we'll have some time to talk about that. Very, very fascinating technique that has been developed using mass spectrometry called mass cytometry, which has really increased our ability to characterize the immune system in detail, in such detail that was never possible before using any other technique. And then at the end, exposomics. As we talked about the environment, exposomics is concerned with analyzing everything that you are exposed to. That may be drug, that may be you know, your nutraceuticals that you take, your food, your cosmetics, the pollutants, everything that you are exposed to. And some, at some or other level, they go on to affect our biological systems. And really, and this is a area. In fact, all of the omics areas has huge you know, application for machine learning and artificial intelligence, particularly exposomics. because the number of variables are so huge, and trying to identify a pattern there in all that chaos is really something challenging, and big data analysis is really required for almost all omics studies. So let us first talk about right at the outset, let me submit that, as you can imagine, that within these two classes, it won't be possible for me to really cover all the omics, but I will try the general principles and some of the most important ones. So metabolomics is basically study of the metabolome, which is the ensemble of all metabolites, that is the small molecules typically less than 1000 Dalton of endogenous origin within a specified biological sample. And metabolomics indicates to comprehensive analysis of the metabolome of an organism or biological sample. Comprehensive analysis indicates both at qualitative terms, like who all are present there, as well as in quantitative term, how much of each of them are present, but also how they are related to each other. That's the most important part, and how that is related to the phenotype. So now, metabolomics, or just looking into the metabolites per se, is not something that is brand new. In fact, back in 1506, Ulrich Binder published this urine wheel, where he cataloged some of the colors, smells, tastes of urine that was used to diagnose disease. Now, we now know that several of these, one of the examples are probably very common to you. If anybody has high blood sugar, then the smell of the urine will change, and obviously the taste of the urine will change. I'm sure nobody tastes that, but it will change for sure. So back in those days, when people didn't have fascinating advanced technologies, those were primitive ways by which people used to diagnose it. But at the end of the day, these are all because of change in chemical composition of the biological matrix, in this case urine that you are talking about. So in any so this is the idea of metabolomics, and in fact in all omics, that if you have any two given phenotype which are different, then in different with respect to whatever you are interested in, then there must be some change in underlying biochemical landscape. And all we are trying to do here is to characterize different parts of that biochemical landscape. In metabolomics, you look at metabolites, that means molecules which are less than 1000 Dalton. That's all we are doing. So what are these different types of molecules? There is a laundry list of them. In fact, this is ever increasing list, and it is now very well known that we are only looking at the tip of the iceberg. There are several other different types of metabolites, different I will give you at least a couple of examples of such new metabolites. They can come in all sorts of size and shape and functionality. As you can see, they can be acidic, they can be basic, like the amines, they can be charged. They can have a static charge on them, for example, choline. They can be peptides or isopeptide, like glutathione. So they can be of several different type of chemical nature. Now, that is a huge thing to really analyze comprehensively. Now, if you see, for example, when we do genomics, or let's say if you do transcriptomics, we are looking at ATGC or AUGC, and then some of the sugars that are present there, and modifications, couple of modifications that we are aware of. So this is really streamlined as far as analytical challenge there is concerned. That is relatively limited. Even if we talk about the proteomics, there is 20 amino acids, and then you have modifications of those amino acids, which are several, of course, but then it is still a relatively limited number compared to the long release that you can imagine here. And I will show you a chart and you will probably appreciate the challenge and opportunity that is present and metabolomics present. So the chemical diversity that we are talking about is really huge. So now why we really need to invest into research and challenging problem. The reason is that, as we showed you, that metabolome is the proximal, the most. Therefore, so what is happening at the end of this biological cascade, as you can imagine, several of these proteins that we know, proteins as the functional agents of whatever biologically happens. And at the end of the day, proteins, several of them are enzymes, several of them are transporters, and even the signaling molecules eventually come down to some sort of biochemical change in the biochemical reactions that we are talking about. Just to give you an example, that how important this is. So it is surely understandable that wherever a relatively small change will have a huge consequence to the biological system, that's where exactly the regulation will be most tightly controlled. Now let us try to understand, if we are talking about presence of a genomic mutation, so that can be binary. That means it can be present there, or it is like one or zero. So if you convert that into a fold change, it is infinite. Even if you talk about change in transcriptome, etc., and sometime in the proteome as well, people who have done qPCR, etc., finding 5-fold, 10-fold changes in gene expression level is not really uncommon. But just take the example of the disease that we talk about, diabetes. Just a blood sugar level of 100 to 150 at a consistent basis tells you that you have a disease. That means so many upstream biological regulatory pathways has failed to give you just 1.5-fold change in, concentration of a metabolite, and that's a disease, and that leads to whatever consequence we know, several of them. So that means this is exactly where the regulation has to be very tightly done, and that's why we need to understand. So this is like a bottom-up approach, where we first try to understand, if there is two different phenotypes, what is the ultimate change in biochemical landscape there. So look at the small molecules, because they are at the end, and then we walk back to see how this change has taken place, because as we now know that both genome as well as environment can affect the metabolome. For example, you can readily think that, again, the molecule, that glucose we are talking about, that is not only controlled by genome but also your nutrition. Same for amino acid as well as several other things, that your vitamins, etc. So therefore, this is exactly where things are getting decided depending on the biochemical landscape here. So everything else here is trying to control it. So we try to start here and try to go back step by step. And this is how we'll go in this course as well. We'll start with metabolomics and we'll go backwards towards proteomics, etc. So this is what we are trying to focus, So this is what is metabolomics, lipidomics, as well as volatomics, small molecules here. This is proteomics. So, and also to give you another example of why it is so important, now we know that DNA, RNA, protein, and metabolite, these are all, involved in information. Now, if you try to see, some of the metabolites mentioned here, and they go on to change the behavior of all these molecules that we know, and therefore the information. And that's the phenotype. SAM is important for methylation, and then acyl-CoAs are important for acetation, and for nitrosylation, ATP for phosphorylation. It means whatever is happening at the level of metabolites ultimately have it. How these molecules behave. So that's why And obviously, because this is how we are really regulating our, you know, biome and how we respond to environmental challenges, understandably, this is the most diverse of all homes that you can imagine. So this is just a snapshot, and let me tell you, this is a complete snapshot of biochemical pathways that we know of. All molecules present here are only a subset. Day in and day out, we are trying to understand, and we are getting actually new molecules that we are trying to characterize. So as if this was not complicated enough, we now have to understand that apart from our own organs and cell tissues and cells in there, we have an invisible set of living organisms that are present and which co-evolved with us. And we are talking about microbiome, and the commensal microbiota has approximately times more number of cells compared to our own cells. And size of the genome is more than 300 times. So you can imagine the chemical or biochemical potential of the microbiota that is in there, and we'll see some of the examples that how important they are in terms of changing our phenotype. And many of the influences that they exert on our physiology are through these molecules, these metabolites that they are generated. Several of them are very common between us and microbiome, and some of them are unique. If we really want to understand a complete human being from holistic perspective, why a particular individual behaves differently from another, we really need to understand both the products of the genome as well as that of the microbiome, and obviously that includes metabolites produced by them. So what is that we typically want to do? We want to understand who all are there. That means we want to identify staffs, and how we want to quantitate staff, and then we want to understand what is their relationship between. So in order to do that, we have to take advantage of different molecules, and we have to find out what are their different properties based on which we can extract or separate, identify, and quantitate them. And these are different properties that one of them obviously is mass. So typically a workflow of metabolomics looks like that. So you start with organism or tissue or cell or biofluid or excreta. Organism, I have put it purposefully, because not only unicellular, but also we can do in situ analysis of metabolism of multicellular organisms as well, using some of the techniques that has been recently developed. So then you take that, and there is a perturbation, which can be an endogenous or exogenous perturbation, which leads to a phenotype, and you then try to identify why this phenotype has come into place. In order to do that, you do the global analysis of metabolite distribution in intra or extracellular space or environment or whichever sample you are interested in. And some of those signatures can act as markers of that evolution of that particular phenotype. And it may lead to a hypothesis, a testable hypothesis, which you test, validate, not only using metabolomics, but also by combining several other complementary technologies, starting from genomics, transcriptomics, proteomics, as well as several molecular biology tools. And at the end, we would like to arrive at a mechanism and identify, you know, how to manipulate the phenotype. So the steps involved here are study design. So that's basically the statistics, biostatistics part. Hopefully, I mean, somebody will be taking care of that. This is one, although you can tell me and I would love to discuss. Okay, so that study design will depend on what kind of phenotype or objective you are interested in, and also feasibility and statistics. In sample, you have to carefully choose sample keeping, you know, all kinds of, you know, what is the most pressing question, where you are supposed to get the answer, and also what is ethically feasible. Then you have to extract the sample. Sometime you can do an unprocessed sample analysis. We'll hopefully talk about some of that. Or otherwise, you can do a solvent extraction, or you can do a desorption analysis. Then you go to analysis, which is a direct MS or LC-MS or GC-MS, NMR, IR, etc. Then you do statistical analysis, data mining, which can be univariate, multivariate, you know, machine learning stuffs. And then you try to find out what is the feature of interest, what is the feature that is differential between the phenotypes that you are interested in. And then you try to identify what is that feature. And for that, you do a library search, fragmentation analysis. If you are doing NMR, in that case, you do chemical shift analysis. And these are the places where mass spectrometry as an analytical tool is extremely important. We'll talk about that. And then you will get, try to get into a pathway, try to see what are the pathways that are enriched or depleted, upregulated or depleted. You do mathematical modeling, and then you try to come up with a hypothesis and validate integrating other omics techniques or other molecular biology techniques. So these are some of the examples of different metabolites. And as you can see, so the first step, we have skipped the statistics part, the part. So assuming that you have a valid question and strategy, you know, with that, you would first like to then understand, you know, extract samples, I mean, a sample you are interested in. And as you can see, they can vary in volatility, polarity, acidity, basicity, solubility, chirality, or spectroscopic property. So for example, acetone here is a volatile molecule. So if you are trying to do this by something which involves, you know, evaporating solvent, etc., you are never going to look into acetone. Okay. For example, if you are trying to analyze something using something which is, you know, possible only to use aqueous solvent based extraction, you may not get phosphocholine, okay? Because that is very lipophilic. So similar thing. So you have to keep them in mind. I'll give you some of the examples, and hopefully that will give you a glimpse. This is a chart which shows as you go to the right, there are less volatile compounds to the right, less volatile compounds, and as you go up along y-axis, there are more. So if you have something which is less volatile and hydrophilic in nature, obviously you can have aqueous-based extraction. And if you have something which is more less volatile but which is very hydrophobic, then you have to go for an organic solvent-based extraction. On the other hand, if you have something which is very volatile and hydrophobic, particularly volatile, then you may have to do the analysis directly. And that is the range where we have volatomics type of analysis. So directly analyzing volatile compounds. So, and you have to remember that depends on which, what's the state of your sample. So if you have a solid sample, for example, you are homogenized. If you have a liquid sample, so if you have solid sample, you have to homogenize. For example, if you have a tissue and stuff like that, so you have to homogenize. Or if you have an environmental sample, you may need to homogenize. Or if you have something like a cell or something like, you just need to rupture the membrane. So typically, for example, mammalian cells, animal cells in general. So simple organic solvent addition itself is enough. And you have to be very careful, because animal cells particularly just have cell membrane. So just a difference in the osmotic pressure is good enough to rupture the cell membrane. So while harvesting, you have to be very careful to make sure that at that point, you are not rupturing the membrane and not releasing the proteins and enzymes which are inside, because if they are released, then they can react with something and change the biochemical composition that you wanted to look at as it was inside the cell. So often, almost as a rule of thumb, even if there are stuffs which are highly polar in nature, particularly if you are trying to extract it from a living system, whether it is cell tissue or anything like that. So in that case, you will typically introduce some organic solvent which will readily denature the proteins and therefore kill their activity so that they do not change the biochemical composition and you get what was inside the cell. So even if wherever I'm saying that you go for aqueous, typically we introduce some organic solvent. So most of the cases, particularly if they're polar, polar or moderately polar, as you can see, you can use water, isonitrile, methanol, ethanol, or just 80% methanol. So there are several types of, so some combination, some isopropanol, etc. you can use. On the other hand, so this is monophasic extraction, where you just have one phase we want to take. On the other hand, if you have very nonpolar compounds, triglycerides, sterols, etc., you want to use something like hexane or toluene or chloroform, where all these very highly polar stuffs won't be soluble. So that way, right at the stage of extraction, you can simplify the complexity of the metabolome that you are going to analyze. And accordingly, you can use a method which is most amenable for analysis, most appropriate for analysis of those class of compound. So extraction is a very important step and should be done very carefully for further processing. On the other hand, you can do a biphasic extraction where you can have both aqueous and organic layer. So water soluble stuff will mostly come into aqueous layer and organic stuff, hydrophobic stuff will go into organic layer. However, you have to remember there will be stuffs which are soluble in both and they will have distribution between both phases and therefore their effective concentration in each of the phases may significantly reduce and it may go below the sensitivity limit of the technique that you are going to use and therefore you have to be very careful about what you are going to, how you are going to analyze them later on. The reason is, I'll talk about shortly, because sensitivity is a very important thing. You have to always remember, as you can imagine, that at no point, at least till date, we have no single extraction method that covers everything in the metabolome to the fullest extent, like 100% recovery of every metabolite. We do not have any such method. So it is always, if you really want to increase the coverage of your metabolome, you have to fractionate your metabolome and analyze them separately and judiciously. So that has to be really remembered. So this is, for example, this cycle. So as you can see, all the metabolites here are very polar in nature, and you can simply do an aqueous extraction with a little, and that will do for you. Here you have the fatty acid beta oxidation pathway. If you want to analyze that pathway, then most of the stuff here are very highly hydrophobic and therefore unlikely to come into aqueous layer, and you would probably use more of organic solvent based. On the other hand, this is something for you. I leave it for you to think yourself, how would you analyze the biosynthesis of flavonoid in rice? How would you analyze that pathway? What kind of extraction would you use? Or for that matter, how would you analyze that? So now assume that you have extracted your solvent, your analytes, and you now want to analyze them. The primary objectives are basically identification of what are the constituents and quantify them. Okay, that's what we do in metabolism. There can be two kinds of metabolites. One is untargeted, which is hypothesis free, where you want to look at whatever is in there, all kinds of metabolites that may be present in your extract. This may eventually lead to a hypothesis, where you know you start thinking, okay, this is all that had changed, and therefore this may be the pathway or this may be the signaling molecule or the gene which may have been affected. On the other hand, if you have a hypothesis a priori, if you have a solid reason to believe that this is the pathway, for example, if you are looking at something like fumarate hydratase mutation, okay, which happens in some of the cancers. So in that case, you know that this is something to do with the TCA cycle. So therefore, I should look into the TCA cycle. Okay. So this will then test the hypothesis, you know, that okay, this must be affecting the TCA cycle, and the upstream stuff will probably accumulate, the downstream stuff will probably go down, and whatever is in downstream is probably going to be tapered down. Okay, so you can test that hypothesis whether that is happening or not. Okay, so you have to have a solid reason, and I specifically mentioned fumar hydratage here because I'll show you one example that even with so-called classic textbook knowledge about what all fumarate hydratage does, unless you really do an untargeted and unbiased profiling, you may miss a lot. And a significant lot, which we'll show, which was eventually identified by untargeted profiling, a novel metabolite. Because targeted profiling means you are only going to look at a predefined set of metabolites. All your methods are going to be set like that. Nothing else will be looked at. Okay. So therefore, you may miss a lot. So unless you have a specific reason, a solid reason, targeted profiling, you should be, really think through. Now, in all these, exercises, we always need to have something like internal standards. Now, in all stages of like extraction, then analysis, there are, manual or robotic handling of samples, which is not free from error. So therefore, these errors which are being introduced due to either manual or robotic or, machine handling, of the sample or changes in the instrument response over time, there has to be something which will take care of that, which is a known standard, which is piped in universally throughout uniformly, and any change in signal for that particular standard will indicate either it has been. So you can introduce this internal standard at several stages. For each stage, you can have a set of internal standards, and they will tell you which stage the error was introduced, whatever you are seeing. And that really gets rid of a lot of false positive or false negatives that you may eventually pop up at the end of the statistical analysis, because at the point of statistical analysis, you are actually blind. Unless you have these quality control samples, internal standards, you are always going to be fooled. And so typical quality control samples that are used are a bunch of pooled samples which are intermittently injected throughout the run, and blank samples similarly intermittently injected, as well as a set of authentic standards so that you know that your intensity, your fragmentation pattern, your mass error, everything is doing fine throughout the experiment. If not, then you need to redo the experiment. And typically, For untargeted analysis, it is relatively easy. For targeted analysis, typically, isotopically stable isotope level standards like 13C or 15N level standards or even deuterium level standards are used because they have exactly same chemical and physical property. So therefore, everything, whatever happens to the endogenously present compound will also happen to the isotopically labeled compound, and you can normalize any change. Also, targeted profiling is something where you can look into flux through a particular pathway. We'll come to that towards the end of this talk. So where you can actually look into the dynamics through a particular enzymatic pathway using stable isotope tracers. Earlier, people used to use radioactive tracers, but of course they are not the safest thing, and because of the advent of mass spectrometry, now we can use stable isotope tracers, and that has really helped a lot. And we'll also discuss this when we talk about proteomics, probably more extensively. So generally, as you can see, the unlike in case metabolomics can be really metabolome can be really complex. So therefore, you have to and there can be several compounds which may have because we know there is this stereoisomerism, regioisomerism, function. So therefore, there can be several steps which can at the end of the day have exactly same mass or even exactly same chromatographic or even you know other spectroscopic property. So if you want to really separate them, so you have to use something that can separate them on the basis of the property which differs between them. For example, in case of gas chromatography, and these are chromatographic techniques or capillary electrophoresis. So these are techniques that are typically coupled. These are platforms typically coupled in tandem to the mass spectrometer before you actually analyze the masses that are present there, so that you have minimal interference and overlap. So, for example, in gas chromatography, you exploit changes in volatility and distribution between the liquid phase and the gas phase, and then it is suitable for volatile molecules only, and small molecules typically less than 500 Dalton, and something which it heats stable. If it is not stable when it is heated, then obviously it is not good for gas chromatography. Reverse phase liquid chromatography, where partitioning is used, and it is based on the hydrophobic interactions. So the column material is hydrophobic in nature, and so therefore stuffs which are more hydrophobic in nature will get retained longer, and stuffs which are quite hydrophilic, they will not be retained, and thus you get a separation. And you can see these are different types of molecules that you can use the reverse phase chromatography to separate. On the other hand, you can have several types of molecules, particularly you know very important class of molecules like sugar phosphates, then nucleus sugars, nucleosides, nucleotides. They all, if you do RPLC, they will not be retained, and they will come. All of them will come together. So you will have difficulty in distinguishing them. And so therefore you have to use something like HILIC, hydrophilic interaction liquid chromatography, where the phase and the solvent polarity just reverse compared to what you have in RPLC. And then you can also use something called electrophoretic mobility in capillary electrophoresis. So this is based on the presence of charge on that molecule and the jitter potential, and it is electrophoretic mobility in solution phase. So anything that you can have charge that can retain charge in solution can be subjected to capillary electrophoresis. But particularly, mostly, you know, nitrogen containing compounds are easy because they can be easily protonated, and therefore they are easy to you know keep charged in, you know in charge form in the solution. On the other hand, except for very highly acidic compound, for all other compounds, you have to use something which is very basic in nature, and that will have, you know, that is not a very good thing to do for all kinds of glass and other materials that we use. So mostly, amine containing stuffs are useful, and also very acidic compounds, of course. and then you can have chiral chromatography, like D or L isomers of an amino acid, and this is very important because L amino acids are typically that we mostly use, which are biologically most relevant that we have all learned and read about. But there are D amino acids as well, and many of them from plant sources as well as from microbes, including commensal microbiota. As well as there are certain D amino acids that are also indigenously, like D aspartate. Okay, so which are endogenously important as well. So therefore, if you want to distinguish between L and D isoforms of amino acids or sugars or for that matter any other molecule, you have to use chiral chromatography. They cannot be distinguished by any other method, including mass spectrometry. Now, consideration for choosing analytical platform. Of course, it will depend on what kind of sample you have. If you have solid, you have to go for either extraction, or you can directly dissolve them or ablate them, for example, in DESI or We'll at least discuss Maldives. We have discussed. Okay, Desi will discuss. And then you, if you have liquid sample, you can either use them directly, like in direct injection mode, or in NMR, or you can do an extraction and further do MS or NMR. For gases, of course, you have to you can either analyze them directly using GCMS. They are not amenable to either NMR or LC, of course, because they are gas. So in case of NMR, sensitivity an issue, as well as change in pH of the sample would lead to different levels of protonation of labile protons, and therefore change in chemical shift, which gives rise to a problem, including shift as well as broadening of peaks. Direct MS, it suffers from interference. GCMS, you have to make sure that it is a volatile stuff and there is no salt present. LCMS, salt and ion suppressors causes. Ion suppressors includes several of the stuffs that we typically use. For example, trees, phosphate, and all these things, high inorganic salt, all of these interferes with ionization process in LC, inorganic salts. Then capillary electrophoresis, you have to have a heteroatom, as we just discussed. So therefore, if you do not have, for example, if you have an aliphatic alcohol, that's not a great thing to analyze by CEMS. So you have to remember all these before you choose the is just generically speaking, if you have low polarity stuff, low molecular weight stuff, you can use GCMS. Electrophoresis, we'll come to that. Higher polarity and higher molecular weight, you go for CMS. Or variations, including Desi, etc. Now, between profiling techniques, mass spec is far superior. So these are two main techniques that are used: nuclear magnetic resonance and mass spectrometry for metabolomics. However, metabolomics is far more sensitive, and you can use. Mass spectrometry is far more sensitive, and NMR is typically useful when you have concentrations in high micromolar range, whereas mass spectrometry can go down to picomolar and even femtomolar and even more, even down. So if you want to really look into minuscule changes in molecules, for example, like hormones and several other such molecules are present only in very minute amount. So you are not going to look at them or their change by NMR. So you have to really depend on mass spectrometry for looking into those molecules. What important changes. So, and then NMR is not useful for certain types of molecules like fatty acid or fatty alcohol, basically have repeat structural motifs. On the other hand, NMR requires less processing, but mass spectrometry requires significant processing, and mass spectrometry is also typically attached to some kind of chromatography. Quantitation these are two certainly significantly high points of NMR. That is that quantitation is very, very robust in NMR compared to mass spectrometry in general, and NMR gives you direct structural information wherever that molecule is amenable to NMR, and mass spectrometry gives relatively indirect structural information. So there is another point though where mass spectrometry scores over NMR is that you can use mass spectrometry to spatially resolve biochemical distribution, which you cannot do by NMR. So if you really want to distinguish between how your metabolites or proteins, etc., are distributed in a spatially resolved manner, how it is different between two adjacent cells, etc., mass spectrometry is the method, not NMR. So there are two types of analysis, as we discussed, targeted. So in case of targeted, you use something like triple quad or BTRAP, single reaction monitoring or multiple reaction monitoring. In case of GCMS, you use single ion monitoring mode. In case of untargeted analysis, you can use TOF or BTRAP in scan mode, and also in GCMS in scan mode. Now, as I mentioned, that I will discuss at least some of these analyzers. So here is a block diagram which we mentioned earlier. So ion source, we discussed the other day, MALDI and ESI. And today we'll look into electron impact analysis, which is a very very robust and very old, very well established method and very informative method of satellites. And we'll also types of mass analyzers, and we'll discuss a couple of them. So so this we already discussed the other day. So electron impact ionization we'll discuss today, chemical ionization we'll discuss today, ESI we have discussed, we'll also discuss today. Other one, MALDI, we have discussed that today. APCI, as well as there is APPI and LASI and several other variants, which again, for the want of time, we won't be able to do, but if you are interested, please write to me. So electron impact ionization is basically bombarding a molecule with something like 70 electron volt. Sorry? Someone said something? Okay. So by which you just strip off one electron from the molecule and you generate a molecular ion, dot cation, dot radical, so AB dot plus. And the reason 70 electron volt is used, because if you use a lower energy electron, then depending on the bond energy, some of the bonds will break and some of the bonds will not break. Therefore, you will not get a uniform fragmentation pattern. And this is why a high energy is used, so that you make sure that ion is produced, irrespective of whatever compound you use. Okay. So this is typically how it looks. So you have a sample insertion, inlet. So this is mostly in, so you have a volatile sample coming in, and you have a filament from which the electron beam is in these molecules, and these are generated, and then these are then the ion beam is put into the, so here it is written as magnetic field, because that was the first one that was used for analyzing these molecules, and this is a very robust and age-old technique still today, and very powerful technique as well. And there can be other kinds of analyzers. In most mass spectrometers, GCMS, that are present nowadays, you have quad or TOF. So this is where the ions are formed, and this is typically what methanol spectra. That here is this methanol dot plus, which is exactly the same mass, because you can ignore the electrons. Don't have and to distinguish between the dot radical. So you basically get the parent molecule mass, and this is called molecular ion, and the highest ion is called base peak. So this is standard definition, which is used across the board, whether it is ESI or where. So directly produced from molecule through the ionization process is molecular ion. The highest peak is called base peak. Okay, so you can do a little bit of exercise for yourself and try to identify what this is. This is you can what this can be. So you know the atomic weights of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. Try to put them together in a manner so that you get 29, and somehow try to justify the value. So then the problem with the electron impact ionization is that it's a hard ionization technique, as we said, that everything will ionize. And if the bonds present are, they are relatively weak, and particularly in this case, because there can be several types of neutral losses of volatile molecules, for example ethylene, etc. So if you have, for example, a fatty alcohol or a fatty acid, that we lose several such small fragments, neutral fragments, which are gaseous, and therefore the reaction will move forward and you will not be left with any molecular ion. So therefore, it will be very difficult for you to identify where these actually came from. You will always end up with very small fragments which can come from a C14 molecule or a C16 molecule or a C20 molecule or whatever. They will almost all look same. Unless you find out the molecular ion, it is difficult to put together that jigsaw puzzle. So this is why there is another variation of this. The soft ionization technique. So here there is one reagent gas, and that, so first that reagent gas is bombarded with electrons, and then that reagent, into that reagent gas stream, the analyte of interest is introduced. So as you can see, in case of ammonia, this will form NH3 dot plus radical, and then that will give you NH4 plus and NH2 dot. And this NH4 plus, we of course know, is highly acidic in nature, and therefore it will give out its proton very easily if you have an analyte which have a proton affinity which is more than that of NH4 plus. Okay, so it will give up the proton and you will get the protonated ion and ammonia. So in this process, you are not directly hitting the molecule with the energetic electron beam, and therefore the energy in the molecule is less and it doesn't fragment as much. So thereby you can preserve the molecular ion, and you have to remember, so like ammonia, you can use methane where CH5 plus will be the protonating agent, but if the proton affinity of the molecule of interest is higher compared to the proton affinity of the reacting species, then only the proton transfer will take place. If not, then it may form adduct. So depending on what kind of molecule you take, you may also end up in adduct, which are not MH plus. So this is what you have to also remember while you are doing chemical ionization. So if you have adduct, the ionization will be poor and the sensitivity will be low. So you have to be carefully choosing which ionization method you will go for depending on the property. For example, you can see on the left side, so this is the mass spectra of EI mode of and then if you have the CI mode, you can see that 158 M plus is not there, but in CI mode you can see, in this case, this negative chemical ionization was. So similarly, you can have other compounds where you, like here, you don't see any molecular ion peak, but when you use chemical ionization mode, then you can find strong molecular ion peak. So if you need to identify a compound, and if you got the initial fragments, but you don't know what is the molecular ion and therefore where it is coming from, so you may need to switch your ionization mode to identify that compound. So now, several of these compounds, as we know, the first condition in GC-EIMS is that the molecule has to be volatile in nature. Now, if it is not, then you can react it with, derivatize it with something which will make it. Things like silylation and ester formation, as we know, like esters, all these nice smelling stuffs are esters. We know that, right? So ester formation increases volatility, or you can do acylation. So this kind of derivatization can further help to analyze molecules through GC-EMS. So these are some of the derivatization that are typically used. And there is another thing that you must remember, that this derivatization process involves, you know, hitting stuff with some reactant molecule. Now, in that process, as we just said, that because it is GC, it has to be thermostable, but also when it has to be stable with respect to your derivatization. For example, if you are ever trying to analyze arginine using GC-EMS, you are never going to get it. So if you are trying to analyze what is happening to my arginine metabolism pathway I'm trying to look at arginine, you are never going to look at it using GCMS, because arginine under the derivatization condition converts to ornithine. So this is just to show you that you started with arginine, but actually what you get is an ornithine spectra. Okay, so you have to make sure that whatever things that you are taking are actually stable. And particularly if you do not have any particular idea to begin with, what is that is there in your metabolite mixture or in your matrix, then it becomes, you basically learn as you go. So you may and you must not assume that the method that you have used either for analysis or derivatization is going to give you all the answer. You must make sure, and you have to be skeptical about the fact that there can be several things that may happen during derivatization or on column as well. There are several other examples of on column modifications that take place in MS as well. Now, how do we analyze? So let's assume that we have either used MALDI or ESI or EI, just we discussed, or chemical ionization, and we have produced ions. Now we have to identify what is the mass and what is that ion. So the only three properties that you have is charge, mass, and size and shape. So for size and shape, we have discussed ion mobility earlier. It is typically now built in within mass spectrometers just beyond before entering the mass spectrometer analyzer. You have an ion mobility analyzer and other. But at the end of the day, you still have to measure the charge and mass. And these are the different analyzers. This is the slide we probably saw earlier as well. So the most robust, I should say, and the most the oldest of them is magnetic sector analyzer. So this is based on the property of a moving charged particle inside a magnetic field. As we know, there is this right hand rule: charged particle moving charge. Field, and this is a very well-known equation will give you the m by g value. B is the magnetic field, v is the accelerating voltage that accelerated the charged particle first to get into the magnetic sector analyzer, and m and r is the radius of curvature. Okay, so as you can imagine, although we will not be discussing a lot about detectors, but you can readily imagine that depending on different m by z values for a given magnetic field strength and voltage, so only one set of ion will be able to enter the detector if it is a narrow path. And so if you change either the radius, therefore, you can have a detector which is an array detector, and different masses will fall on different places based on their R value. Or you can change the B and V and make different ion to fall on the same place by changing this. So you can scan along B and V, and you can get a mass spectra. So we have quadruple analyzer, which we have discussed a lot. All these triple quad and this tandem MS experiments. So in quadruple analyzers, you have basically four poles, and on these four poles, there are two kinds of voltages that are being applied. And as you can see, there schematics of these four poles. And, along x direction, there is this plus voltage on both, and on yz plane, there is negative polarity. The ion is moving along the z axis. So now, as you can see, any ion will have a stabilizing potential along xz plane, whereas it will be destabilized along the yz plane. Let's say if you assume this is a positive ion, if it's a negative ion, it will be the other way around. Okay. So typically, along yz, it will be destabilized, and along xz, it will be stabilized. So if nothing else happening, then eventually, depending on how heavy or how small this ion is, they will hit the yz. The poles on the yz plane. Okay, So now what happens that we give a periodic voltage is the schematic for the periodic voltage. So it is changing the voltage at a particular frequency. So if you keep on changing them, forget about the constant voltage before. So just consider the periodic voltage. If you keep on changing them, so it is attracted towards the opposite pole, and before it is going to hit it, it is changing, going to change polarity again, and it will going to circulate. And since it has started with the initial velocity along z direction, eventually it will pass through if it is stable enough throughout the trajectory. Now what will happen that the constant and periodic voltage is applied simultaneously. So what happens? So this faint ones indicate the constant voltage, and the ones, the sign in the inside the circle indicates periodic voltage phase. Okay. So as you can see that if you have a positive voltage along xz, when to start with xz is stabilized, and then along yz it is destabilized, then it will suddenly change, and then the ion will try to move away from the this, and it will try to go towards the negative pole again. So again, assuming that this is a positive ion, for negative it will be the other way around. So it will change again, and eventually what will happen that light ions will get constrained by U, which is the constant voltage. But when V is larger than U, so the light ions will be pushed so hard so that they will be unstable, because light ions have they will gain higher momentum because they are light. And if they have same charge, let's say if you have heavy ion, light ion with same charge, then light ion will get deflected more, and they will be unstable more along the xz plane. So therefore, along the xz plane, the light ions will be unstable depending on the relative, the frequency, the magnitude of U, V, and position of course, the ion. So they will be destabilized, and only heavy ions will be passing through, because they are too heavy. Before they move too much, that polarity will change again. On the other hand, on the yz plane, heavy ions will get destabilized by the voltage U, and if the V is not strong enough, then because the momentum is high enough and V is low compared to U, then the heavy ions won't be retained along yz. They will hit yz because they are too heavy to push back by a small U. So therefore, along yz plane there will be a cutoff, and only small masses will be allowed. Now if you now keep moving the voltages along both xz and yz, the combined effect will be only a select narrow range of masses will pass through the quadruple, and you can select that range by choosing the frequency and the magnitude of U and V judiciously. So by scanning these or by changing these parameters, you can create a mass spectra. So now I want to show you here. So now you imagine that if you are not scanning, if you fix this U, V and the frequency in such a manner that only a certain set of, you can see this narrow range of mass only passes through, so this will act as a filter. So this is why almost in all tandem mass instruments, except for probably Orbitrap and stuff like that, a quad is used as a filter, mass filter. So initial selection of mass is done using a quad. And then if you turn off all the voltages, then it will allow all the masses to pass through. And this is where when you can introduce a gas which will collide with these ions and will fragment it. And this is what happens in the second quad. So the first quad selects, you can allow the second quad to fragment stuff, and the third quad you can again use as a scanner by changing U and V and frequency. So this is how a triple quad is used to generate a tandem mass spectrum, and also it can be used. So if you can fix the UV and omega on both quad 1 and quad 2, so you can precisely control that which ions are allowed to pass in quad 1 and quad 2, and in between the fragmentation will take place. So you can select the parent ion and you can also select the daughter ion. Depending on the voltages and the frequency that you choose, you can either select a difference between mass of parent and daughter ion, so therefore it will only look for a neutral loss, or it will look for a specific type of daughter ion. Let's say in case of a phosphocholine, it will look for a phosphocholine head group. In case of LPCs or PCs, or if it is a sulfate kind of molecule, it may look for a sulfate anion. So you can do various kinds of analysis, which we discussed earlier. We'll have that slide again. So this is how triple quad is very useful for all kinds of tandem analysis, as well as for targeted analysis of molecules. So what is done here, time of flight is also a very simplistic analyzer. So here the ion source is here, and there is a backplate, which is, if it is a positive ion, then this is a positive voltage, so therefore the ions are repelled, and this is at a relatively lower voltage, so there is a voltage gradient, and that therefore these ions are repelled and moved towards the grid, so there is an acceleration that it gets because of this backplate, and these accelerated ions are then allowed to enter this field free region, and depending on whatever the mass and charge they have, they will have some sort of kinetic energy that will be characteristic of that particular mass and charge ratio for that ion. So based on that kinetic energy, because it is a field free region, it will float through and it will reach the detector, and the time that it takes to reach the detector will be dependent on the kinetic energy. So therefore, again, if we just show the here, the smaller ions will reach fast and the heavier ions will. So by just analyzing the time of flight in the field free region, we can find out the m by g value. So this is the equation that is given, where u is the accelerating voltage and delta is x is the drift. Now one thing is there, that even within even if two ions are of same m by g value, they may have slightly different kinetic energy depending on how close or how far they were when they felt the backplate voltage. So there is always a distribution of kinetic energy even if the particles are same. So that is something that will certainly cause a distribution of time of flight, and therefore a broadening of the measured mass. Okay, so if you want to really take care of that, so for that there is this reflectron design, and most of the TOFs now being used are reflectron. There are two advantages. First of all, you will take care of that kinetic energy distribution broadening, as well as within the same flight, within the same physical space, you will double the flight path. As you can imagine from this equation, that the resolution will increase with increase in flight path. So instead of one, it will be almost double. The flight path will be double and the resolution will be higher. And also, the ions, so these are positively charged plate. Again, we are starting with positively charged stuff. So it is repelled by this 100 voltage, so it will 100 volt. So therefore, it must not be able to cross 110 volt. So it will start here. The ions with lower kinetic energy won't be able to penetrate through more. With the higher ones, with the higher kinetic energy, with same by m by g value, will be able to penetrate little higher. And they will come back and get refocused on the detector, and thereby giving you a sharper peak. So after doing all this analysis, so you have basically got your m by g values, and you would like to then you know, get, so you will get, so you have done some chromatography and then you have measured the masses. So you will get something like this, which we call this mass chromatogram, total ion chromatogram. So this total ion chromatogram or TIC can be deconvoluted like this. So let's say this is the peak, this is a small peak. It may actually be a combination of three different, you know, ions or three different metabolites coming, and they are overlapping with one another. So you can do a Gaussian deconvolution. There are several types of deconvolution algorithms available. And for each of these, so for each of these deconvoluted peak, you see what are the coeluting ions, which are the ions that are covarying with time. And you, by doing that, you get the mass spectrometer, I mean mass spectrum. And from that mass spectrum, you generate retention time and ion M by G value pairs. So those M by G values and retention times pairs are characteristics of each of these metabolites, and they are defined by the retention time and whatever mass they are showing up. So after doing all that, so you get a matrix which where you have these different features, which are basically all the ions, which are retention time and M by G pairs, and you have intensity values for all these features. So you can integrate that chromatogram and get intensity for each of the ion. You can extract the ion intensity, and you, that is reflection of the relative abundance. So after that, you have to do some statistics, which is principal component analysis or PLSDA or other things. We'll discuss some of them. And so there are things like, this is called samples plot, and this is ions plot, and each of the dots here indicates a sample. In this case, it's a mouse study, it's a mouse, and each of the dots here indicates an ion. So ions which are loading on this side are probably up here. Ions which are loading on the, let's say, right side are probably higher in the samples which are scoring on the right side. So from that, you identify which are the features which are upregulated or downregulated in the particular sample set that you want to look at, and then you identify that. Then you have to do something called data normalization. Why? Because there are artificial variabilities. We talked about those QC samples. You know, there can be biological variability. Simply, if you take, let's say you are taking a sample, if you take a lot of water, even without any change in your actual physiology, all the concentration of different metabolites in your urine will go down. So therefore, a sample taken before water intake, after water intake, people will, if you don't normalize, if you don't know that you have taken water, you will think that there is actually a physiological change, which is nothing. You have just taken water. Or there can be manual or technical issues. And so so these are actually issues, and these are actual normalization and procedures that has to be followed irrespective of whether we are doing lipidomics, proteomics, all kinds of omics. All this kind of normalization and this data processing is very similar. That's why I'm going through this. So there are three different kind of normalization which you can do. One is internal standard normalization. If you have spiked in an internal standard uniformly, any change in its intensity is indicative that somewhere, either manually or you know, in the instrument, something had changed. So you normalize with respect to the internal standard intensity to get uniform thing. Total ion count or sum normalization, this accounts for both manual, technical as well as biological variability. I'll give you an example. And endogenous normalization, if you know that there is some you know, endogenous marker, you know, unfortunately, in most cases, unlike in case of, let's say, genomics or transcriptomics, where, you know, particularly transcriptomics or proteomics, you have proteins or transcripts, which you can use for as a housekeeping gene for normalization of, you know, your loading or, you know, the signal that you get, you know, 18S or beta actin, GAPDH, several. But in case of metabolome, it is, we do not have, except for very few cases, like in case of urine, you have creatinine. In case of, you know, serum or even urine, other biological samples, let's say in cells, etc. You can use total protein for endogenous normalization, but we do not have a really uniform endogenous normalization procedure for metabolomics. So you have to be careful about that. You have to really look into your data to make sure that you have got everything right. So, and then there can be, the data can be transformed because, you know, often the variability is too high and there is huge dynamic range. Therefore, the data distribution, the statistical distribution of the data is often not amenable to a particular type of statistical test that you want to do. So you want, if you want to reduce the variability and if you want to move towards a more, you know, nice Gaussian distribution kind of thing or things like that, you can do a log, square root, or cube root kind of transformation of the data. So this is, for example, it's a data normalization example. So you have three samples, S1, S2, S3, and these are variables A, B, C, D, E, and these are intensities. So if you can, if you add them, so you find in one case it is 100, in another case it is 50, another case is 55. So the total intensity is different, and even in the individual intensities are also different between these samples. You can see, let's say S1, S2. But if you do a TIC normalization, you will find that actually S1, S2 is same. When you divide this by the total, you will find that this is the relative abundance of each metabolites, and this is what we are looking at, the relative abundance. That's exactly the same. So this will tell you that S1, S2 is basically the same sample, probably got diluted somehow or whatever, or somebody took a lot of water. S3 is a different sample, okay? The total is same, but the relative distribution is different. You can also do endogenous normalization. For example, assume that A is the, let's say, is creatinine in case of urine. So A is the molecule by which you are normalizing everything. You can see that if A becomes 1, S1, S2 remains same, but in case of the S3, it will be different. So then principal component analysis, I'm not sure how much time do I have today. Because some of the statistical part, etc., is very interesting, but maybe I have to skip because I may not have a lot of time left. Can somebody answer me?
So you have 15 minutes.
Okay. Okay. So maybe, these are, you know, so I thought that I'll describe the, you know, philosophy behind the principal component analysis and how it exactly it is done and how the data actually reflect it. But, you know, maybe I will really run through this. So principal component analysis looks to explain the variability, the overall variability in the sample. And this tries to look into the inherent clustering pattern. This is blinded. You don't tell the algorithm that this is one group, this is another group. The program is, the algorithm is blinded to the classes, okay, sample classes. And this is not good for feature selection. And so this is an example of a principal component analysis. Here it is a wild type and mutant. This is from one of our studies. You can see that the mutants are on one side and this is on another side, on the first principal component itself. And that is where the most variability in the sample is. And you can see the sample as we were showing that here is one something that is loading on this left side. And this is probably up in the mutants. And you can also see that in this case, the mutants were tumor-bearing mice. Not only it was up in the mutants, but also wherever there was higher tumor load, this concentration was also higher, okay? Eventually, we'll know what this molecule is. So supervised analysis on the other case, on the other side, is aware of class. This is prone to overfitting because you are telling that, yes, this is group A, this is group B. Now, give me anything that is different between these. Now, that anything can be spurious, that anything can have, may have no actual correlation with your, you know, what is happening biochemically. It can be an artifact. It basically does a model overfitting. It pushes the model to extract something out and push the groups apart. So these are different types of supervised analysis, PLSDA, OPLSDA, random forest, volcano plot, and all these things. Most of the time you will see this kind of, you know, volcano plot, a heat map, type of thing, random forest. But you have to be careful that these are supervised models and may have model overfitting issue. So PLSDA, so there are several ways to actually take care of that. Unfortunately, we don't have time to get into. PLSDA, for example, can compare. If you have more than two groups, you can have PLSDA. If you have two groups only, you can use OPLSDA. This is for an example. In PCA, you can see this is a study from of arsenic stress response in rice in collaboration with BRC. Here you can see the PCA do not really distinguish stuffs a lot. Okay, but if you have PLSDA, you can really push them. And this is really useful in order to identify features, because PCA is often driven by the most abundant stuff. So if the most abundant molecules are not changing, then you may not actually be able to figure out what is changing using PCA. So there is always pros and cons in PCA and PLSDA. One has to be carefully choosing that. This is called SPLOT. It is also used for feature selection. So stuffs that are you know, shown in red up here, it is up, and those in shown in green, this is down, while comparing between wild type and tumor bearing mice. So this is very easy visual representation of the data to pick up the features that you want to eventually identify. Now, if you want to identify, then you have to you know, think about resolving power, mass accuracy, calibration, all these things that we discussed before. And all these, you know, different types of ionization, you have to remember what kind of ionization you have chosen, what is the possible adduct, and what is the common fragment that is possible. So because you now have a retention time and a mass, you are trying to identify what is that mass. So you are trying to, you have to be very sure how accurate this mass measurement is. For example, TOF typically 5 ppm, Orbitrap almost 1 ppm, and FTICR less than like 1 ppm, around 0.1 ppm. Typically 1 ppm accuracy is good enough. Now, if you go below that, it may not give you a lot. 1 ppm is good enough. Even 5 ppm, 2 ppm is good enough. So this, for example, showing, you know, sodium adduct, potassium adduct, as well as solvent adduct. As you can see, this is acetonitrile adduct. And in this case, there is in the negative mode, as we discussed, there can be chloride adduct or formate adduct. So then you look into, you try to, you know that, okay, this is exact accurate mass. Now you would like to put all these elemental masses together, try to build what is the possible chemical formula. There is something called Sewell golden rule. It's a heuristic set of rule that has been discussed in detail by Tobias Kind and all. And Oliver Fein. So you can look into their paper, 2007 paper, that one. And so, and then you find out a plausible chemical formula, and according to that chemical formula, if that is true, then you should get a expected pattern of isotopic distribution, because all these have certain stable isotopes. Okay, so you should have an expected pattern of M plus one or M plus two peak based on your formula. For example, if you have C6H12O6, which is sugar, which will have approximately 6.9% M1 peak, because 13C is 1.1. And there are 6 13C. Okay, then you have certain contribution from hydrogen. So in case of methylamine, you will have 1.5% and so on and so forth. If you have chloride containing compound, it is very easy, because we know that chloride has a very strong M plus 2 peak. So you, for example, in case of air, which is a chlorobenzene, you can see 112 and M plus, which is 14. And there is something called nitrogen rule. This stems from the fact that nitrogen is the only guy among the CHNOP type of molecules which has a even mass number, which is, but a odd valency, which is 3. So this gives certain, you know, rise to this specific peculiar property, by which if you have a odd mass that indicates odd number of nitrogen, in case of specifically EI, So we'll have a set of conditions under which it is applicable. If you have an even mass, this indicates either there is zero or even number of nitrogen. So if you have odd mass, there is certainly one nitrogen if it is a organic compound. So this holds only for nominal masses rounded up integer, and only for compounds made up of this kind of elements. And for EI, this rule can be applied to parent molecular ion, but for ESI, MALDI, DESI, so this is basically applicable to parent molecule. So if you have something where the ion is generated by protonation, deprotonation, etc., you have to take into account and apply this rule only to the parent molecule, whatever mass it is expected to be. And it is only applicable to normal valency satisfied structures and not to fragments. Okay. So anyway, these are some of the examples that you can see and you can do for yourself how many nitrogens these are. And then once you have got the accurate mass and plausible chemical formula, you would then like to find out, there can be several compounds with same chemical formula, but different functionality or different kind of isomers, residue isomers, functional isomers. So in order to find that out, we have to look into the fragmentation pattern. So for that, as we discussed, in case of triple quad or two-top or such kind of instrument, you can do three types of scans where you look into the what are all the product ions, or if there is a particular kind of precursor ion that you are interested in, and you, for example, you know that I'm just looking for all phospholipids, then you look for the phosphate as a phosphocholine. You look for the phosphocholine as the daughter ion, and you see who all gives phosphocholine. So you only look for them and find out the parent masses which gives phosphocholine, or you can have neutral loss wherever there is a neutral loss. This, I think we have discussed. And do MSN analysis. Then while interpreting spectra, you have to remember that basic chemistry rules still applies. Fragmentation follows whichever is the weakest bond would fragment first, and the protonation deprotonation sites also changes the bond strength. So for example, if you have a bond which is not so weak, but if you have a protonation next to that, that can induce polarity in the bond, and that can significantly weaken the bond. Okay, so similar simple chemistry rules actually apply. So and including all these plus R minus R effect, stabilization of the product ion, etc., everything you have to take into account. So these are some of the examples you can look for yourself, where for example, here a loss of sulfate is in, and that is basically a signature that all these compounds are sulfate conjugates. So these are the changes in masses that you would expect. And so based on the change in mass, so you start with something and you suddenly see that there is a set of molecule or one molecule which has a change in mass, which is exactly, let's say, 14 mass above, 14 unit above the parent mass. That may be methylation. So based on that, you can immediately try to think what is the upstream event that may be happening. So you should be looking for an enzyme which may be methylation related enzyme. So similarly, demethylation, hydroxylation, acetylation, epoxidation, all kinds of modifications can take place. And by looking into just mass, you can identify what they are. So once, similarly, if you have this kind of conjugates and corresponding ionization modes, then you can have neutral loss of the corresponding moiety. For example, in case of glucuronide, 176, in case of the glucose conjugates, it's 162. Just looking into this kind of signature in the mass spectra, that there is a parent mass, there is a loss of 176, you would immediately know this is a glucuronide. And you can further confirm it by using glucuronidase. So if you use glucuronidase, that parent mass will be off, and you will get exactly the same mass where the deglucuronidate conjugate is supposed to come. So by doing all these things, you have to identify. So this is some of the examples where aldehydes and ketones are identified in EIMS. So it can either undergo alpha cleavage. So one thing between aldehyde and ketones, alpha cleavage in case of aldehydes leads to M minus one peak. So if you have two molecules having same exact mass, one aldehyde and one ketone, you would know whichever is giving you a M minus one peak is certainly aldehyde. And then they can have McLafferty rearrangement. This is because of the six-membered ring. So this has to have this 1, 2, 3, 4. On the fourth position, you have to have a proton. Only this takes place. And for aldehydes and ketones, this gives you. So in case of aldehyde, this will be 44. Looking at these, you can identify what are the functional groups that are present. And there are some of the examples here, and then McLafferty. So then in case of GC particularly, there is a huge advantage because this is a very robust technique and very old technique, well-established technique. So there are libraries present, so you can match your library, the spectra that you have get with the library spectra. For example, we have done for palmitoic acid and acid with, here. And you can see there is a significant match here, and it will give you the, what is a plausible compound. But at the end of the day, you have to, the confirmation, the real confirmation has to come through in most cases, and this is the gold standard for confirming a molecule in metabolomics, and is by using the authentic standard and spiking in and showing that it is retaining at the same time, it is eluting at the same time, and also giving exactly the same fragmentation pattern. You can see for phenylacetyl glycine, this is the molecule I showed for the tumor bearing. So, and also in all this, there are a lot of databases that helps you to identify plausible masses. So in while doing the searches, you have to give the query mass, the mass that you have experimentally got, your expected mass error range, which you know from your authentic standards that you have used, and after that, and possible fragmentations that are possible or adducts that are possible. I wanted to show some examples, but because we are running short of time, we won't be able to show that. So you can use all this database, and these are some of the tools and resources for using data deconvolution and pathway of network analysis that people use in metabolomics. And so far we have been talking about taking a snapshot and telling that what all are present, how much of they are present, but that doesn't tell you that what is the flux. Okay, so what is the dynamics that is present there? So in order to really know, then you have to put flags on the molecules that you are looking for. So those flags are isotope levels. They can be radioisotopes and stable isotopes. As we discussed, radioisotopes are almost outdated now. We use stable isotopes and mass spectrometry to track flux through a particular pathway. Okay. So this, for example, there are different types of flux analysis. One is stoichiometric flux, where you basically identify concentration of each of the metabolites, and by looking at their relative distribution, you infer that what is the flux through this particular pathway. But as we know that the enzymatic processes are far complex, far more complex than that, there are reversible processes as well, backfluxes as well, and each of them will leave their unique biochemical signature. For example, for the same process, if we started with 2,13C labeled glucose here, this is how the isotopically labeled pattern will look like. Okay, so as you can see, the backflux will give you a different isotopically labeled pattern. So even if the ultimate distribution of overall the compound is same, but their stable isotope labeling pattern will be different. For example, in this case, M plus 2 and M plus 4, all of them originating out of different types of flux through this biochemical pathway. And by looking at that, we can really know that which is the biochemical pathway which is getting affected, because many of these pathways, like the forward and backward pathway, are actually catalyzed by different molecules. For example, if you think about glycolysis and neogluconeogenesis. So There are at least three states there which are catalyzed by different molecules, and we also have different isoforms of the same enzyme that catalyzes different types of reactions. So we'll give you an example. So looking at that isotope distribution pattern, you can find out what is exactly the dynamics of this biochemical pathway, and therefore which gene or which protein we should look at. The different tracers that are used for flux analysis, and then all these, though still looking at the distribution of molecules, whether it is static or dynamic, which is looking distribution of molecule without any special resolution, because you are extracting these metabolites, and the moment you extract, you lose information where it came from, which cell or which part of the cell. So this is where the atmospheric pressure ionization, the ambient pressure ionization techniques are becoming important, where you can deduce specially resolved information. In this case, DC, this is very similar to electrospray ionization, but what you are all doing is that you are spraying a set of charged solvent droplets through a nozzle, and that droplet is hitting your sample here, for example, and that is dissolving, this is dissolving some of the analyte here and dissolving it, and then it is sputtering out, and there is the mass spectrometer inlet here, and then you are analyzing. So you can keep on moving this platform, and by which you can look at the distribution of metabolite at different spaces. Okay, this has been really useful. For example, here they looked into the non-tumor and tumor tissue. They showed using DESI directly from the Abraham Hooke is actually the father of this ambient ionization techniques. And they showed that you can see different distribution of biochemicals between tumor and non-tumor. And not only that, you can have different distribution of chemicals between tumor and adjacent normal within the same specimen, tumor and non-tumor tissue. This is the cancer, and this is the epithelial tissue and the muscle tissue. The distribution of metabolites are different. And this is something that you cannot find out just looking at the histology or even immunohistochemistry. In fact, this imaging can be done for proteins and peptides as well. Therefore, from the same sample, you can get to know about distribution of several different types of molecules, which is not possible even with immunohistochemistry, because you have good antibodies for only so many proteins or chemicals, different biochemicals. So this is hugely useful to really understand the change in biochemical landscape in real tissue. In fact, this has been further modified. Now they can do this imaging analysis on the operation table using something called REIMS, where they use a laser to ablate, to evaporate and ablate some of the metabolites. And there is a tube that sucks it into the mass spec and analyzes it. So as the surgeon is cutting the tissue, operating the patient, he is getting signatures regarding distribution of molecules. And by that, he can decide where, how much to cut, where to stop, because several times when you are dissecting or you are operating, tumor margin is left, and this leads to relapse and all. So this is very powerful, this sort of MS based imaging techniques on live samples. You can also do single cell metabolomics. I guess I am running out of time, and so maybe I'll leave the slides, and if you are interested. So this is particularly useful if you are trying to segregate cells. For example, let's say in an in vitro fertilization thing, which embryo you should take in a out of different embryos you have, so those kind of analysis where you really need to specifically identify a particular cell type. For example, here they showed that the neurons that were freshly cultured, that were cultured and freshly isolated, they differ a lot in terms of their biochemical composition. and that will obviously have effect on how these cells behave. So therefore, really phenotyping, I mean biochemically phenotyping cells are possible at single cell level using mass spectrometry. However, the resolution is still a problem, and these are some of the examples. Maybe I'll discuss other ways. These are very interesting examples. I will discuss with next class and get go on with proteomics and lipidomics as well if I get time. So with that, I would like to stop for the day, and thanks for your attention. And if you have any question queries right now, I can tell you. Let us at least talk about this one. So here is this fumarate hydratase I was talking about. So in this case, you can see the on the right side, the fumarate hydratase got mutated. And if you are only looking at the TCA cycle, or for that matter, the other parts of the central carbon metabolism, you would never know that the unutilized succinate, that is because fumarate hydratase, if it is not used, then succinate will build up, and that succinic acid will combine with glutathione, and that will give you something called succinic glutathione, and that will deplete the glutathione pool and reduce the glutathione pool, and therefore the ability to fight off oxidative stress, significantly affecting the fate of these cells. Okay, so this won't be possible if you were just focusing on a particular set of metabolites. So untargeted metabolic profiling and looking for novel metabolites, you know, something which is extremely important. And maybe I will leave you with the challenges that we have here. So incomplete coverage, one example I gave, couple more examples will give you next day, and very limited dynamic range. Looking into metabolism live as it happens, we are not able to do for most of the cells now. Unknown metabolome, their biochemical origin and functional implication, including metabolites which are exchange between the host and microbiome. These are all important aspects which are challenges and opportunities in understanding biology really in a holistic manner. So with that, I'll stop. Again, please, if you have a question, let me see if there is any question.
No question yet,
huh? Okay,
yeah.
So next class, day after, we'll, one day after that, okay, 29th, we'll start with some of these examples and go on with the rest of the omics. Okay, thanks a lot. You can send questions later on also via email, etc.